السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا وإمامنا محمد بن عبد الله، وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. O Allah, we do not have knowledge besides that which you have granted us. For indeed you are the most knowledgeable, most wise. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. O Allah, grant us knowledge that is beneficial and benefit us from the knowledge that you have granted us. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن عين لا تدمع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن بطن لا يشبع ومن دعاء لا يسمع. O Allah, we seek your protection from knowledge that is of no use. We seek your protection from eyes that will not cry for your sake. We seek your protection from a heart that will not fear you. We seek your protection from a stomach that will never be filled. We seek your protection from a soul that will never be content. And we seek your protection from a dua that is made that is not answered by you. يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث لمعاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه أملك لسانك. فقال معاذ بن جبل أو إنا مؤاخذون بما نقول يا رسول الله. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم ثكلتك أمك يا معاذ، وهل يكب الناس على مناخرهم في النار إلا حصائد ألسنتهم؟ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honorable scholars of deen, brothers and sisters in Islam, my dearest mothers and sisters, we have been granted many gifts by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a child is born, we become happy. We see the child and immediately it brings a smile to our faces. More so when the child is absolutely normal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us normal children. All those who may be ill and sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure them. And all those whom Allah has decided that they do not have a limb or two, or that they have a problem or two from birth, remember, to the parents of those children, it is a jihad. Your reward in turn is that you will be resurrected right next to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That is the patience. If you bear it, the reward, I have just told it to you. So if I were to pose a question to you today, what is the most important organ of your body? What are you going to say? I have asked this question in the past to many people. The first thing they tell me is the heart. The heart is the most important organ of the body. This is the first answer that I get. Why do they say it is the heart? Because they say the heart pumps blood to the entire body. If that heart stops, the person is regarded as dead. However, when I tell them I disagree with that, they tell me, well, maybe then it is the brain. Because wallahi, the brain differentiates between man and animal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Indeed, we have created man in the best of postures. We have given him the best brain, the best posture, the best hands, the best eyes and noses, etc., etc. That is the distinguishing factor between ourselves and animals. But unfortunately today, we have become worse than animals. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ فَلَهُمْ أَجْرٌ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ. After we have granted man the best of postures, we then dropped them to the lowest of the low, besides those who are true believers. Those who are true believers and do good deeds, we did not drop them to the lowest of the low. Myself and yourselves, inshallah, we have a shahada, kalimatul haqq, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is not only on our tongues, but even engraved in our hearts. That is what makes us better than animals. As for those who don't have iman, Allah says they are worse than animals. Why? In the Quran, Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ. Indeed, they are like cattle, and they are worse than cattle. Those of us who have any experience with animals, if you are to feed an animal on a daily basis at 6 o'clock, wallahi, at 5 to 6, the animal will be waiting for you. No sooner does the animal see you than it will start racing towards you, and it will come towards you knowing that goodness comes from this man at this time, from this direction. And if you are to beat an animal, the next time the animal sees you, it will run away from you because it understands that evil has come from this direction. Wallahi, what is wrong with man when man knows that this is good and this is bad, and man still goes towards bad? Even the animals don't go towards bad. And man still stays away from good. Even the animals come racing towards goodness 5 minutes before time. Allahu Akbar. Look at why Allah is telling us that I have dropped you thereafter, even below the animal. The cattle understand, but we don't. Subhanallah. So some might say that the most important organ, some might say the most important organ is the brain. But wallahi, there too, there is a bit of disagreement. From my part, try again. So they will tell you, okay, it is the hand, because through the hand I can write, I can eat, I can drink, I can shake people's hands, I can earn, I can achieve, I can work, so on so forth. Wallahi, that just shows us the importance of these organs, the heart, the brain, the hand, and so on and so forth. But that is not the most important organ. Some might say the eyes. Why? Because through the eyes I can see. Wallahi, you know, when you have a color television, you need to adjust it. You need to make sure that you have fine-tuned it just so that the picture comes out clear. Have you ever thought, we don't have knobs on the sides of our heads that we need to tune our eyesight? It is clear crystal for us. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Have we ever thanked Allah for that? We need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really to thank us for the gifts He has granted us. The eyes, very important. Those without ears will tell you that wallahi, the ear is more important than the eyes. Why do they say it? They say it because they don't have the ear. Ask those who cannot hear properly. May Allah grant us crystal clear hearing. Let me speak about the radio. We know how we tune it to try and catch our favorite stations. And we have so much interference and so on and so forth. Do we ever have to tune our ears? Do we have a knob at the bottom of our earlobes that we turn round and round? No, we don't. The voice comes straight to our ears, crystal clear. It does not need any tuning. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. That is the Creator. هَذَا خَلْقُ اللَّهِ فَأَرُونِي مَاذَا خَلَقَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ. That is the creation of Allah. So show me what those besides Allah have created. Wallahi, they have created nothing. That is the greatness of my Creator and yours. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Allahu Akbar kabira, walhamdulillahi kathira, wa subhanallahi bukratan wa asila. No matter how much we praise Allah, no matter how much we thank Him, wallahi, we will never do justice to the gifts He has given us. If He were to charge us 1 cent for every breath, we would be bankrupt, subhanallah. Not only has He given us free air, but He has given us air that we can breathe. How many people are dying elsewhere because the air is contaminated? If we are to remain in sujood for our entire lives, we will not do justice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One might say the most important organ of the body, the legs, the feet. Why? Because we walk with the legs. We get to the masjid. We do what we want. We go to visit people. So on and so forth. Wallahi, they have a valid point. But all they are showing us is the importance of these organs. In brief, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها. Indeed, if you are to count the gifts of Allah upon you, you will never be able to circumscribe them. You will never be able to count them all. Today we look at what we have not been given, and in the process, we forget what we've been given. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. Indeed, if you are going to thank me for whatever I have given you, I will grant you increase more and more. You have a problem. You might not like what your nose looks like. Thank Allah for everything else He has given you, and you will fall in love with that nose of yours. Allah has created different people, different sizes, different shapes, different colors, because everyone likes a different set of organs, subhanallah. A different look, a different color, a different texture. If everyone was supposed to be the same, today we would not be falling in love with one another in order to marry. Because it would be like a factory. Left pairs, right, when they create the doors of the motor cars, the doors don't fall in love in order for them to be on one vehicle. It is not by their choice that they are put on the same vehicle. The fact that they happen to be the same shape is what has decided that they will be on the same car. But today we have different shapes and sizes and colors and creeds and so on and so forth for us to fit in like a jigsaw puzzle, subhanallah. Some like big, some like small, some like short, some like tall, some like dark, some like pale, and so on and so forth. That is why Allah has created the different colors to give us a gift in this dunya, which unfortunately we don't even appreciate. Some of us might look at ourselves in the mirror and say, oh, I don't like this, I don't like that. Na'udhu billah min ash-shaytanir rajim. We seek protection in Allah from shaytan the condemned. How dare we even decide that what Allah has given us is not good for us? You don't like your nose, go and see those without noses. You don't like your mouth, go and see those without mouths. I have seen a man when I was studying in Madinatul Munawwara, whose mouth happened to be below his ear. La ilaha illallah. The most scary person I've seen in my life. And that is when I appreciated to say, Ya Allah, you have granted us. Alhamdulillahi ala thalik. So this shows us that no organ can do without the other. I read the verse, if you are to count the gifts of Allah, you will never manage. We will only start with our own bodies. Forget about getting to food and drink and water and so on and so forth. In the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, when a man comes on the day of Qiyamah saying, Ya Allah, I have done so much ibadah for you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say two things. Alam nasihha laka badanak wa nurawwika bil ma'il barid. Have we not given you already in the dunya good health? And did we not quench your thirst with cold water when you most needed it? That cold water we gave you is enough to compensate all the ibadah that you've ever engaged in. La ilaha illallah. When we enter Jannah, we will enter Jannah together only with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not our deeds. We try and we try our best, but wallahi, it is the mercy of Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, that will drive us to Jannah inshallah. Ameen. These are the gifts of Allah. This is what Allah has created. We take it for granted. But we have not yet answered the question, what is the most important organ of the body? Can I tell you? Each organ is important for its field and for whatever responsibility it has been given. But the one that makes you or breaks you is your tongue. It is your foreign minister. What is in your heart cannot be told unless you wag your tongue a little bit, subhanallah. Anything important is locked in a safe. You have a jewel, a gem worth millions of rands, you lock it in a safe. And that safe, you put it in a strong room. And the strong room, you ensure there are guards all around. Anyone walking close to your yard is a suspect, subhanallah. Because we know how precious this gem is. So Allah automatically, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, has granted us automatic protection. The tongue does not have one bodyguard, but wallahi 32, and they are very sharp, subhanallah. The tongue is never seen to be sticking out, otherwise we would be dogs. All of us here, our mouths are closed. If our tongues are showing, we would be sick. We would need attention and help. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a message. I placed this most important organ somewhere for a reason. It is not displayed in public because its use is very limited. You are not meant to just utter whatever comes into your mind and heart. Remember, there are 32 checkpoints you need to go through. Ask yourself 32 times. And for this reason, sometimes we tend to bite our tongues. Allah is reminding us that is a gift. If I were to mention one sentence, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, how many times did my tongue hit the top and the bottom? I have lost count. But how many times was it bitten? Not once. Allahu Akbar. Look at the Creator. I told you, Hada khalqullahi. That is the creation of Allah. فَأَرُونِي مَاذَا خَلَقَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ. Show me what those besides Allah have created. I only want to see something looking like a tongue. Subhanallah, they can't. Even if they get together. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the powers of this dunya, the powers that may be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا لَهُ. Those whom certain people call besides Allah and certain people worship them besides Allah, they will not even create a fly, even if they gather in order to do that. Allah is showing you His greatness. A fly, something we regard as detested, nobody can create a fly besides Allah. Allah says they will not create a fly, number one. Number two, even if they all gather together, they still won't create that fly. And number three, Allah says, forget about creating the fly. وَإِن يَسْلُبْهُمُ الذُّبَابُ شَيْئًا لَا يَسْتَنْقِذُوهُ مِنْهُ. If a fly takes something away from them, they will never ever get that back from that fly. لا إله إلا الله. When a fly sits on the sugar, what it did to the sugar, you will never ever return that back to the sugar. Subhanallah. Look at how insignificant anything we are doing is. And anything anyone who wants to compete with Allah will ever do, will never reach, even the smallest creature of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I was saying, not only has the tongue been given 32 bodyguards, but over and above that, it has a strong room which it is closed into. We know that the lips are placed so carefully above, covering even the teeth. When you have a guard, everyone knows there is a guard. But when he is in plain clothes, you fear him more. Subhanallah. If we were to walk showing our teeth, we might look silly. So Allah has covered those teeth with lips. MashaAllah. Let's thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has granted us. Allahumma laka alhamdu wa laka ash-shukru. And thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put a command center through which everything that the tongue does will have to seek permission from. What is that command center? The brain. So your brain is the command center. It is the organ that will determine and grant the green light or the red light to the lips. That will in turn show the teeth, that will separate, that will then allow that tongue to move. Subhanallah. This is the tongue. And thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept a secondary backup that is always necessary in order to give its opinion towards how what is going to be said should be said for the purposes of feelings. And that is the heart. The heart is connected to your feelings, how you feel, how others will feel. If you are to use your heart in conjunction with your brain, you will succeed. Don't let your heart rule, nor should only your brain rule without any feelings. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a very close relation between the heart and the mind, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا. They have hearts which they don't understand through. Allah is speaking of the mushrikeen. Why did Allah say the hearts don't understand? Because understanding is also connected to the hearts. Allah did not say لَهُمْ عُقُولٌ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا. Allah did not say they have brains that they don't understand from. A brain is normally meant to understand, but it is meant to be connected to the heart as well. Let me move further. The tongue is such an organ. جَرْمُهُ صَغِيرٌ وَجُرْمُهُ كَبِيرٌ. Its size is very small, but its damage can be very severe. Very severe. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, straight to the point. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever believes in Allah and the last day must either speak that which is beneficial, or they must gag up and keep quiet. When you are arrested, what happens? The policemen are meant to tell you, you are under arrest. You have the right to remain silent. Subhanallah. I see we are silent even when we are asked to speak. Subhanallah. I think we're getting more scared than we should. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you utter may be held against you in the court of law. Don't we hear the statement? Why do they say this? Because that little organ of yours that has no bones in it, yet it moves so much. It is the fastest, quickest mover in your whole body. And it moves to the degree that you lose track of it. If there were speed limits, we would all be fined. Subhanallah. When you utter a word or two, let me give you an example. The same policeman asks you a few minutes later, what did you do? Tell me, what are you going to say? I'm waiting for my lawyer. See my lawyer. My lawyer is coming. That will be your statement of the day. Anything he asks, my lawyer. Subhanallah, they might ask you, how old are you? If you are guilty of something, you might say, wait for my lawyer. Subhanallah, because you know, you don't want to put yourself in a predicament whereby they might hold something against you the day you are in front of the judge. Subhanallah. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that already through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that everything you utter may be held against you in the court of Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal after you die, then we are not worried. Subhanallah. About the dunya, we are worried. We won't utter a word. But when someone asks us questions regarding our deen, regarding things when we are not arrested in our lives, when we have to speak to our wives and our husbands and our children and the members of the community, we speak how we wish, not realizing that we are hypocritical. Because for the dunya, we will remain silent and say, speak to my lawyer. But for the akhirah, we will never say, the sheikh told me to say this. Who are our spiritual lawyers? Tell me, are they not the ulama? Why then do we not say, sheikh said that this is how we must talk, I'm going to be quiet. When she screams, you keep quiet. When you scream, I'm telling her to keep quiet. We can't both scream together, or we will have ice cream. Subhanallah. We have fuel, we have fire. The fire becomes bigger. Can there be fire without fuel? No. And there cannot be fuel just like that. Subhanallah. When someone is shouting in the home, the other must remain silent. Why our marriages are breaking? We both want to scream. We have a screaming contest. Who is screaming louder? Subhanallah. And unfortunately, the judges are the children. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Our children are made to stand and see, right, mommy and daddy are screaming. Tell us, who is boss? Subhanallah. Unfortunately, nowadays they'll even tell you, mommy is boss. Subhanallah. The scales are tipping, my dear brothers and sisters. Let us learn how to control our tongues. For definitely, in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every moment of silence will be regarded as an ibadah. If you have remained silent for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When there is a problem, you are about to utter a swear word, and you remember the court of Allah, and you gag yourself, wallahi, you might get the reward of an umrah because of your silence. To solve a dispute between the Muslim ummah is a greater ibadah than you can imagine. And to stop a problem before it has been created is also an act of worship that is so great, it is impossible for me to describe the reward to you today. When you most want to bubble and burst, remain silent for the sake of Allah. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْضَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah is praising those who drink up their anger and those who forgive other people. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, praising those who drink up their anger. Allah says, Allah loves those who do good. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah loves those who do good. What is the goodness they have done? They drank their anger. They controlled their tongues. They ensured that when they were bubbling and bursting with heat, they were silent. This is why the ulama have mentioned, following up with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when a person is angry, if he is standing, he should sit down. If he is seated, he should lie down. If he is lying down, he must drink a little bit of water. And the ulama have followed up and said, the biggest remedy for anger, subhanallah, hold water in your mouth when you are angry. Try it, my dear brothers and sisters. When you are angry, hold water in your mouth. And believe me, you will never regret what you have said. Why? Try to talk, the water will drop out, subhanallah. You can't utter a word, there's water gagging you in your mouth. Hold it in your mouth when your anger is cooled. Let it go down your throat, subhanallah. That is an act of worship. How many of us have spoilt our business relations, our marital relations, our parental relations, our relations with our children and fathers and societies and communities, international relations, just because of an outburst whilst we were angry? And afterwards we became from amongst those who regretted it. That is why once Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu walked into where Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu was seated, and he saw a strange sight. Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu had his tongue sticking out and he was holding it with his left hand. And Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu looked at him, baffled, amazed, amused. What are you doing, O Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu? He looked at Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu and he said, "Inna hadha huwa alladhi awradani al-mawarid." This is the organ that has got me into whatever I have got into. This is the organ. And it's a fact. Today in the home, the husbands are known as mad because of how they use their tongues. Wallahi, I warn you about the workplace. Whether you are working for someone or whether others are working for you, watch out how you speak to them. Allah is going to take record of that and you will be responsible on the day of Qiyamah. An Anas radiallahu anhu qala khadimtu Rasulallah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 10 sinin fama qala li uffin qattu wama qala li shay'in sana'tuhu lima sana'tah. Subhanallah. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu says, I served Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 10 years. Not once did he say, for anything I did. Not once did he question what I did. If I did something wrong, he would rectify it, looking at me with a smile, subhanallah. And we claim to be lovers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet, sometimes we are a disgrace to the same Nabi. We have left his teachings on one side and we claim to be his followers. When we are driving, there is something known as road rage. Not only do we use our fingers with new signs every day, But we use new languages every day. The F word and the Z word and the W word. Subhanallah, you might be confused. That's because I am too. There are new words that come out every day, which are used derogatory. Al-lisanu illam tashghalhu bidhikrillahi shaghalaka bighayrihi. Your tongue, if you are not going to keep it occupied in remembering Allah, it will keep you occupied in wrong language, in that which is wrong. You must keep your tongue occupied in the remembrance of Allah. And part of the remembrance of Allah is to be silent. You can remember Allah when you are quiet as well. And you can remember Allah whilst your tongue is moving. The hadith says, "Tuba, good news to the one whose tongue is wet constantly with the remembrance of Allah." Today our tongues are wet with what? With everything but the remembrance of Allah. How we talk to those who work for us. How on earth can we be so arrogant to them? Even if we are paying them, who knows, two generations down, their grandchildren might be the bosses of our grandchildren. Then how would you like it if their grandchildren had to treat your grandchildren the same way you were treating them just because you employed them? But later on, their grandchildren will employ your family. Allahu Akbar. تِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. The days, Allah says, we rotate them around the people who were rich yesterday, today they are poor. Who are poor today, tomorrow they will be rich. Wallahi, we know how it works. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us in such a way that our tongues don't stick out. That is a sign to say, watch out. Don't use your tongue too much. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us in such a way that wallahi, when we utter, that is how we are known. Today I have spoken, I will be known as someone who has spoken in this manner. If I speak swear words, I will be known as a vulgar man. If I am silent, I will be known as a quiet woman or a quiet man. If I am someone who is soft-spoken, they will say this man is soft-spoken. If I am someone who is extremely abusive with his tongue, they will say he's a bad person. They say, and this is an English saying, I thought he was thick until he opened his mouth and confirmed it, subhanallah. I thought he was stupid until he opened his mouth and confirmed that not only is he stupid, but he is very stupid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. Silence is a sign of intellect and intelligence. From amongst the qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, طَوِيلُ السَّكْتِ لَا يَتَكَلَّمُ فِي غَيْرِ حَاجَةِ. Subhanallah. His portions or periods of silence were long. He did not speak unnecessarily. Now that does not mean when they are asking you a necessary question, remain silent and look at them and wink with your eyes. No. And then you say, today Sheikh told us to be quiet. No, no, no. When you are asked to speak, think and speak. Look, your children are making noise. You can either tell them to shut up or you can either say keep quiet. Which word are you going to use? Tell me. You want to be respected. Are you going to say shut up or you are going to say keep quiet? Reduce the noise levels. Tell me. Keep quiet. I see we are quiet. Subhanallah. Why? Because now your brain is talking to you. Your brain is confirming with your heart regarding the feelings of your children. And your brain is telling the heart, and the heart is telling the brain that instead of shut up and keep quiet, I'd rather use the term keep quiet. It is much more respectful even towards my own children. So today we are sitting in the masjid. We have confirmed that keep quiet is better than shut up. But go home. What word are you going to use? Shut up. Why? Because now you don't even allow the command center to pass the resolution. You use the word in anger. So you've used the wrong word. When we are sitting quietly, we use our brains. We know what word to use. But on the spur of the moment, the road rage I was speaking about a few moments ago, I overtook him I'm driving a worse car. He's driving a better car. If I don't take out my gun, let me first try my hand signs. If the hand signs don't work, I can start making words. Though I know he won't hear them, but he can see it's the F word. Subhanallah. That's our attitude. And who are we? Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. Is that how he wants you to be? Road rage, let him overtake you. Slow down, stop on the side. When he's gone, you pull off again. He'll have wasted his fuel. Believe me, I try it sometimes. You find at the traffic light, someone is revving next to you. They bounce a little bit. They're revving next to you to tell you, yes, I'm going to give you a go. What you do, let them take off, blowing 5 liters of fuel. And you are slowly following them. They feel like fools. Subhanallah. They wanted to give you the race. You admitted that maybe your car might overtake mine, but my brain overtakes yours. Subhanallah. That is a Muslim. These are the qualities we need to talk about today. Subhanallah. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His command. But let me tell you, in our homes, and I'm repeating this again, how we use our tongues will determine what type of people we are. خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ The best from amongst you are those who are best to their own families. And I am the best to my family. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said this. When your wife in your absence can praise you, you are a husband, subhanallah. You are a husband in a million. When your wife can praise you in your absence to her closest buddies and friends, to her own family, you are someone. And when you can praise your wife to your own family in her absence without her knowing, then she is definitely one of the hoors in the dunya. May Allah grant us. But today they complain about us, we complain about them, to everyone and anyone. So much so we don't need to complain. The neighbors will come and say, hey, you had a torrid night last night. I could hear it. I hope they weren't hearing the wrong things. Subhanallah. Screaming, shouting at the top of your voice without being shy of your own neighbors, of your own children, of those around you, people driving past. I thought the music was loud these days, but wallahi, I've heard people screaming. Subhanallah. When you go to America and Britain, the houses, some of the walls are made of compressed cardboard. Believe me, you can hear everything that goes on. We need to understand, they don't allow, there is an aircraft flying past right now. We can hear it. In Heathrow, they don't allow aircrafts that do not have hush kits on them to land because there's too much noise. There is disturbance. Imagine, some of us would need hush kits in our mouths because of how we use our tongues and how abusive we become. When you are known as a gentleman in the home, you will now be a gentleman outside. What do we do today? Let's face the facts. Let's face the facts. We might turn red in our faces, but the facts are about to be opened up. We meet a woman on the streets, and we talk to her with the broadest smile, the most beautiful of voices. We will actually change our entire tone. Subhanallah. Just to try and impress her. How are you doing? I'll help you, don't worry. If you could only help your wife at home, subhanallah. You want to impress the women on the road. Those whom you don't know. They don't know you. You are not mahram. They are not married to you. You want to impress them. You will smile at them. You will speak to them with your heart. Totally, subhanallah. That is why the hadith says the best of you are the best to your own family members, your own wives. Because we know when you come out of the house, you can be a hypocrite. Half of the wives will say, oh, when someone says you've got a good husband, what will they say? If only you knew. If only you knew. Some of them might even say, well, you can have him. Subhanallah. I don't think that statement will come so quick because even if they shout, they know. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness. We need to be conscious of the fact that charity begins at home, not on the street. Charity starts at home. Your wife doesn't have a blanket and you're giving a blanket to the lady next door. Subhanallah. That is the wrong statement. Your own children haven't heard you speaking so melodiously. Subhanallah. And yet the children of that woman have already heard it. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. They think you are super dad, not realizing that if only they had to come to your home for 5 minutes, they would realize there is no term to describe you. Allahu Akbar. That is the message. Let us be good. You know, I need to qualify this statement before I go on. I once spoke about wife bashing. And I said, wife bashing in Islam is haram. We are not allowed to batter our wives to the degree that we break their bones and everything else. We know that it's haram. And when I completed my lecture, a certain man came to me with a blue eye and said, Sheikh, you forgot to speak about husband bashing. Subhanallah. So for that reason, I better mention the other part as well. The women also need to understand charity begins at home. When you answer the phone, hello. Subhanallah. You can't speak with that tone to your own husband. But to those who don't know you on the telephone, mashallah, you've dropped your tone and played it to the degree that had you had to sing, you would be competing with Madonna and the likes. It is a problem in the ummah today. And we claim to be ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hypocritical. My message here today, let us make our behavior Islamic behavior. Let us be an asset to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Control this tongue of yours. And inshallah, you will have success in the dunya and the akhirah. In this dunya, when you have misused the tongue, let me tell you what happens. I give you a little example. The example is that of a great businessman. And it is a true example. They made large profits on the stock market for their company. And he uttered a word to say, oh, they were interviewing him on the television. He said, yes, we are proud to have made money on this crap that we are selling. Na'udhu billah. Immediately he uttered the word, the share prices went down. They dropped and crashed. The people of the world who had bought into this share sold up their shares because they said, if he is really selling something that he is terming crap, why should we buy it? And he suffered such a great loss. Wallahi, the company closed down within a space of 3 months. I'm speaking of the 1990s. I remember reading it in the papers. So for business also, we need to understand, you know what happens to us? We got businesses. All those who have businesses, listen carefully. To sell our ice in winter, we need to go to them. Hey, you know what? This is very important ice. It's known as hot ice. So now you feel hot in winter. Subhanallah. Oh, is it? Yeah, come touch it. You'll get burnt. And wallahi, touch it and you get burnt. We know hot ice. I'm sure we know what I'm talking about. So now they sell you ice in the middle of winter. They will talk to you so nicely. They will offer you food and drink. Wallahi, go to Makkah and Medina. They do it there as well. I know I lived there. They will offer you food and drink only because they want you to buy the kaftans that they are selling. And they will tell you this and that. And they will come and tell you what and what not. Subhanallah, why? They want to sell you a commodity. For the rand, for the dollar, they know that we must use our tongues properly. But for Allah, they will not know that. Subhanallah. When you tell them, how many times did you do dhikr? And how many times did you earn the rand that Allah has? They are lost. Well, sorry, what are you talking about? Do I understand what you're saying? And you look at them. They look baffled. Subhanallah. Today, they say money speaks. I change the statement. Wallahi, money screams and shouts. But our tongues that are meant to be speaking in the right direction, neither do we speak in the right direction, nor do we utilize the tongue in the right direction. Subhanallah. Imagine, for dunya, that's what we do. A Jewish man will come to you to buy your stock. You treat him like a king because he's buying your stock. But a Muslim brother comes to you, or your own wife comes to you, where charity is meant to be beginning, Forget about charity. Even if she told you, look, I pay you 100 rands, be nice to me. We would look at her and give her a slap on the face. What are you talking about? Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness. Wallahi, I wish to end with a litmus test. I wish to end with something that will wake us up, not only today, but forever. Do you want to know if you are a good Muslim or not? I can give you the litmus test. How do you test yourself? My dear brothers and sisters, if you want to know if you are an asset to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or if you are in the wrong direction, wallahi, I will pose a question to you, a series of questions. The answers of those questions will answer the question, are you an honest and good Muslim or not? Think for a moment, visualize, picture yourself sitting in your house. You are seated as you would normally do on a Sunday afternoon or any day. What you normally do in your home, think of it. Whether you smoke your cigarettes or whether you listen to your music or whether you have unacceptable videos and so on and magazines, your mobile phones, everything, your computers, the internet, what have you in your house, the alcohol, the drugs, whatever there is. Think of a normal day. Have we pictured it? We are seated in our homes. The door is knocked. Someone knocks on the door. How do you answer the door? We know how we answer the door, don't we? We stand up and rush towards the door. Sometimes if we don't, and the man rings the bell again or knocks the door again, we might even utter swear words to say, who the hell is he? Or who are they? They can wait. They can go away. We need them in our home. I remember visiting a home in India when I was there. The little girl came out and said, my daddy told me to tell you that he's not here. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. That's the affairs of the Muslims today. Subhanallah. My daddy just told me to tell you that he is not here. I said to the girl in return, tell your daddy that I said, Jazakallah khair. I know he's not at the door, but I want him to come to it. Subhanallah. So the question is that knock on the door. You react, you open the door, and suddenly you get a shock of your life. Who do you see? Just picture it. Just imagine it. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam at your doorstep. He knocked on your door. You opened it. You saw him. Your reaction will tell you what type of a Muslim you are, my dear brothers and sisters. If you bang the door back at his face and say, wait, let me dress properly. Let me go and hide the pornographic videos I have. Let me hide the drugs. Let me cancel the meetings I've had tonight. My cell phone has dirty messages on it. Let me quickly do this and that. Let me quickly hide these music cassettes I have. Let me do this, that, the alcohol in the fridge. Let me throw it away. If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam pitched up at your door, how would you react? Wallahi, that reaction will tell you whether you are a genuine Muslim or whether you need help. And if he were to tell you, my dear follower, I am with you to stay for 1 week, what would you say? Hey, not this week, next week. You know what? We've got a lecture at that masjid. Please, I'll see you there. Just go to the masjid. I'll pick you up from there. Don't worry. No. It's all right. Please, excuse me. Just, you know, understand. So on. That is the reaction. How you react to that man when he visits you, that is how you will understand what type of a Muslim you are. Think of the toilets you have. What do you have in your toilet? What type of a loo do you have? What do you do in your toilet? Unfortunately, some toilets I go to, I see the rules of golf on the shanks. Subhanallah. These are the golfers. What do they do when they sit in the loo? They pick up the magazine, open it, the rules of golf. Subhanallah. Others keep different magazines in the toilets. I've seen it. Would we have them? Amazing. Think very carefully. My dear sisters, my dear mothers, how would you be dressed? When Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants to spend 1 week with you, will you allow it or will you reject it? Will you have to cancel, my dear youth, your Friday night and Saturday night appointments and tell them, you know what, next week, not this week, I've got a guest. Subhanallah. That means what's wrong with what you are doing? Because it's unacceptable to the very man you are following. That is why you got to cancel it. If you were doing nothing wrong, you would say, welcome, welcome, enter the house. Here, this is the place where I read my salah. This is where I read all your sayings. And this is where I read the Quran that came to you, that was brought to us through you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where I read it. This is what I have done. I am trying to be a better Muslim. Please make dua for me. And so on and so forth. This is my reaction. I will be going to the masjid in a few minutes. Let's go together. Subhanallah. That's your reaction. What do you have to hide? Why do you have to hide anything when you're a good Muslim? But it's only when there is something wrong with you, you will have to shun him from the door, open it, see him and bang the door, na'udhu billah, on his face. To say, let me quickly put something more appropriate on. Allahu Akbar. Look at how hypocritical we've become. With that litmus test, I ask you all to think about it very deeply tonight and to ponder over it and to effect positive change in your lives and my life, inshallah. The message is for me as well as for you. I am more in need of whatever I have said than you. And with that, I come to an end, seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Allah to make us from amongst those who are true followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who can control their tongues and those who are an asset not only to their wives and families but to entire communities and societies and to the Muslim ummah. Jazakumullahu khayra wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.